In this video, we will discuss on persistent left superior vena cava. It is the most common congenital malformation of the thoracic venous return. Before proceeding, we will discuss the normal venous anatomy. Right internal jugular vein and the right subclavian vein joins to form the right brachiocephalic vein. Similarly, the left brachiocephalic vein is formed by the union of left internal jugular vein and the left subclavian vein. Right and left brachiocephalic veins combine to form the superior vena cava, which then drains into the right atrium. Now we will discuss the development of these veins to understand in detail about the persistent left superior vena cava. By the third week of the embryo development, the two endothelial tubes fuses to form the heart tube. It has arterial end and venous end. The arterial end is the truncus arteriosus and the venous end is the sinus venosus. Between them are bulbous caudis, primitive ventricle and the primitive atrium. We are now interested in the sinus venosus part of the heart tube. It is divided into body and two horns, namely right and left horns. Each horn receives three sets of veins, namely vitelline vein, umbilical vein, and common cardinal vein. The common cardinal vein divides into anterior cardinal vein and posterior cardinal vein. In the course of time, the right horn enlarges and the left horn regresses. The right umbilical vein and part of the left umbilical vein near the sinus venosus regresses. The left vitelline vein also regresses. The right vitelline vein persists to form the suprahepatic portion of the inferior vena cava. The enlarged right horn forms the posterior smooth part of the right atrium. An oblique connection develops between the two anterior cardinal vein. It forms the left brachiocephalic vein. Superior vena cava is formed from the right anterior cardinal vein along with the right common cardinal vein. The right posterior cardinal vein forms the root of the azygous vein. The regressed left horn of sinus venosus forms the coronary sinus. The left common cardinal vein forms the oblique vein of the left atrium. Now our topic of interest comes. The left anterior cardinal vein regresses and it becomes ligament of Marshall. When the left anterior cardinal vein persists, it forms the persistent left superior vena cava. This is how the left superior vena cava is formed. It is the most common congenital venous anomaly in thorax. It is present in 0.5% of normal population and it is present in 5% of patients with congenital heart disease. Right superior vena cava is also present along with the left superior vena cava in 80 to 90% of cases. Left brachiocephalic vein is present only in 30% of these cases. Only in 10% of cases, the left superior vena cava is seen in isolation. That is, all the venous blood from the head and upper limb drains into the heart via the left superior vena cava. The left superior vena cava drains into coronary sinus in 80 to 90% of cases. And in the remaining 10 to 20% of cases, it drains into the left atrium, causing right to left shunt. Left superior vena cava as such doesn't cause any symptoms and the people are usually asymptomatic. So the diagnosis of left SVC is usually an incidental finding during any cardiovascular imaging or surgery. For example, left superior vena cava was incidentally detected in this patient after placing a central venous catheter by chest x-ray. Here, The central line was inserted via the left internal jugular vein and it reached the left superior vena cava as shown. Let's see the second example. In this patient, during the placement of the permanent pacemaker, the venous angiogram was done of the left subclavian vein. It showed the persistent left superior vena cava. In echocardiography, if the coronary sinus is dilated, one should suspect persistent left superior vena cava. During cardiac surgery, when the right superior vena cava is small or there is absent left brachiocephalic vein, one should look for the left SVC. So when we find the left SVC incidentally, what are the clinical implications? The presence of left SVC mandates to rule out associated cardiac anomalies. The most common are atrial septal defects. If the patient is having left SVC, one is to be very careful in doing interventional cardiac procedures, which requires left upper limb venous access. It may injure the coronary sinus, leading to cardiac tamponade and death. If left SVC is not addressed properly during cardiopulmonary bypass, it is very difficult to run the cardiopulmonary bypass machine, or it may cause a bloody operating field. And presence of left superior vena cava is a relative contraindication for retrograde cardioplegia administration during cardiac surgeries. And lastly, the left SVC is associated with increased risk of arrhythmias. So we end the video here. Hope this video was helpful and see you soon in the next video.